Good morning, family. Welcome this morning to Bible Way Community Baptist Church, the place where Jesus Christ is Lord of all and the Word of God still transform life. We're excited and delighted to have you this morning worshiping the Lord with us right here at Bible Way. Listen, you still got time. You still got time to call your friend, to call your neighbor, call your prayer partner, and let them know that Bible Way is on the air. Let them know it's time to tune in this morning to the exciting Bible Way Community Baptist Church. Oh, let them know, Lindsay, we got a wonderful message this morning on being blessed. So they need to hear this message. So call Bebe and Buki and Buddy them. Call them all and let them know that we're on the air this morning. Listen, you see me this morning in my coveralls. Yeah, I got my overalls on this morning because we are celebrating our Black history. And see, at one time, this is all that folks had, ladies and gentlemen. Matter of fact, they just had one coverall, just one thing, a coverall, and they would have to wash it up and then go on and get a hot iron on it and then go on to church the next day. But look what God done for us. We got school clothes, then we got a set of church clothes, then we got a set of work clothes, then we got some play clothes. We got clothes for every occasion. A matter of fact, people got some clothes that you could just have a room full of clothes. You know, they got some houses that they ain't just got a little bitty closet. I mean, they got a room for a closet now. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we ought to just be thankful. Anybody ought to be thankful. We ought to be thankful to what God has done and where he has brought us from. Now, listen, I don't know for sure. People been wanting to know. Pastor, y'all, Sister Wilbur, going to cook them turkey necks and neck bones. And well, I don't know. But when I get home, I'm going to find out. And whatever Sister Wilbur cook, that's what I'm going to eat. And I'm going to be just like those little kids on the Camel Soup commercial. I'm going to eat it all up and I'm going to say, good. Oh, yes, because it's going to be good. And so whatever you have, you be thankful too, and you make sure that you give God the praise and make sure that you give him all the glory for giving you a good cook. Amen? Amen. All right. Listen, we're celebrating Black history, so watch this Black history moment, and then I'll see you in church.
Welcome to The Schoolyard, the show where we break down some of history's most unknown historical figures of color. Today we ask, who was Robert Smalls? Robert Smalls was a congressman who escaped slavery by posing as a captain on a Confederate supply ship during the Civil War. Smalls was born April 5th, 1839 in Beaufort, South Carolina. His father, although officially unknown, was said to have been his plantation master, John K. McKee. This granted Smalls favoritism amongst the community. His mother Lydia didn't approve of his more privileged lifestyle, fearing that his complacency would blind him from the cruelty of slavery. It was with a heavy heart that she would force him to endure every aspect of slavery, even going as far as exposing him to the whippings of other slaves. His exposure to the horrors of slavery would fuel his rebellious nature. Several times, the plantation owner McKee would have to bail him out of the Beaufort jail due to his defiance. Lydia's plan of direct exposure had worked all too well, but she soon feared for her son's life and asked for him to be sent somewhere where he could build a life, not destroy it. At the age of 12, McKee sent Smalls away to Charleston to work as a shipbreaker and a waiter. Unfortunately, Lydia, his mother, was sold while he was away, and he would never see her again. He worked several jobs in Charleston and was paid a pretty decent wage, but he was only allowed to keep a dollar a week. That's right, $1 per week, which is about $28 today. The rest would be sent off to McKee. Smalls eventually got the opportunity to work on the Planter, a Confederate transport steamer. He fell in love with the idea of becoming a sailor, with the dream of one day sailing towards freedom. In 1858, Smalls met and married Hannah Jones, a slave girl who worked at the Charleston Hotel. They had two children together, but because of slave laws, they were unable to live with one another. They had to request permission from their masters, the McKees and the Kingmans. Permission was granted to them to live in a small apartment in Charleston, but they remained slaves. The Kingmans could take Hannah and his children in the blink of an eye for any reason. Small sought out their freedom, and the Kingmans agreed to sell his wife and his children to him for an insane price of $800, which is a little over $22,000 by today's standards. At the time, he only had $100 to his name, so he would have to find another way. In May of 1862, the opportune moment would finally present itself. At the dawn of the Civil War, the Planter, the ship that Smalls had worked on since his teenage years, was being used to transport guns, ammunition, and important documents to Confederates. His plan was to take the ship, pose as its captain, and sell his family and 12 other slaves away from Charleston and towards freedom. On the night of May 12th, the white officers decided to sleep in town. Smalls wasted no time preparing the ship for departure. This daring escape led through several Confederate checkpoints where he would have to give the right signal for each. If caught, he and the other passengers were willing to go down with the fight. The Yankee ship, the USS Onward, was the first to spot the Confederate ship and nearly fired at Smalls until they saw the waving of the white bedsheet, the signal for surrender. The Planter and its contents were given to the Yankees, and Smalls, his family, and the other slaves were soon granted their freedom. In one fateful night, Smalls risked everything to free his family and the family of his crew. His endeavor was recognized by Abraham Lincoln, which became one of the many factors that encouraged him to authorize free blacks to serve in the Union military. Smalls would join the military himself, eventually becoming a Union Navy captain, conducting several missions near Charleston. He also had a stint in politics, getting elected in the South Carolina House of Representatives and serving as a congressman from 1868 to 1869. He returned to Beaufort and bought the very house in which he was a slave. He remained there until his death at the age of 75. It goes without saying that Smalls died a hero.
Hurry up now, go! I don't need a church.
Good morning again, family. I want to talk with you again on our series of messages about the blessed life. As a matter of fact, I want to bring the series to a close. And I hope that you have enjoyed this series as much as I have enjoyed studying and bringing it to you each week. And today I want to look at a message that's entitled, Can You Handle the Stress of Being Blessed? Can you handle the stress of being blessed? I'll never forget when I graduated from high school, I was working for this little store called TGNY, and they put me on their management training program. Because at that time, I thought I wanted to be a manager, and I thought I wanted to manage my own store one day. And so they put me on this management program. They gave me the keys there to the store. I started coming in, opening the store, staying late, closing the store. I went to work every day in a white shirt and a necktie, had a lit name tag and what have you. Everybody was calling me Mr. Wilbert. They used to call me Tim, Stock Boy Tim, Stock Boy Tim. But now everybody was calling me Mr. Wilbert, Mr. Wilbert. Oh, I enjoyed that. Going there, open up the store, going there, closing the store. Working long hours, though. I would go 8 o'clock in the morning and open up the store. I was supposed to get off at 6. Most of the time, I didn't get off at 6. And then people would ask me, Mr. Wilbert, can you stay around and do the clothes? And just stay around and give us that closing speech. Because can't nobody do the clothes and like you do the clothes. And so I would stick around to about 15 minutes to 9, and then I would go up there and get the mic, and I would give the lit closing speech. I would say, attention TGNY shoppers, we're now closing. Will you please make the final selection and bring them to our checkout area? We'll open from 9 to 9, 6 days a week, and 1 to 6 on Sunday. Thank you for shopping at TGNY. Good night. And then I would go home. But most of the time, I had to stay there and work another hour and a half. So I stopped doing that, ladies and gentlemen. And then I noticed that the more that I work and I was good at what I was doing, people just was calling me more. Mr. Wibbert, can you come and do this? Mr. Wibbert, can you do this? Mr. Wibbert, can you come in early? Mr. Wibbert, can you stay late? Mr. Wibbert, can you come on in? Even though I know tomorrow is your day off, but can you come in? Mr. Wibbert this, Mr. Wibbert that. And it looked like I was just hearing, even in my sleep, Mr. Wibbert, 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 Mr. Wibbert. I said, oh no. I was tired of folks calling me Mr. Wibbert. I said, oh. That's got to be something else that I can do that's less stressful. That's why I asked the question, can you handle the stress of being blessed? I want to look at a man by the name of Joseph, one of the most blessed men in the Bible, but he also had a stressful life as well. Because once you are blessed, there are four things that normally comes along with being blessed. The first thing that comes along with being blessed is when you bless, people will hate you. Yeah, people will hate you when you bless. Look here at Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37, beginning with verse number 3. The text says, now, Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him, underline that, and could not speak peacefully unto him. Oh, it's on now. It's on like neck bones now, ladies and gentlemen. And Joseph dreamed the dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. That's the second time when I saw that word hate. And he said unto them, hold on just a moment. Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. Now they already hate him, but now he make him hate him more because he's been to tell him about his dream. He said, for behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheave arose and also stood upright, and behold, your sheave stood round about and made obeisance to my sheave. In other words, they bowed down to my sheave. And his brethren said to him, shall thou indeed reign over us? Shall thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him. That's the third time. They hated him yet the more for his dream and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it to his brethren. And they said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. They bowed down to him. And he told it to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, what is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee to the earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. Oh, see, his daddy caught it. His daddy, you know, Jacob, he had had experiences with God and dreams and vision, and he caught it when he understood that the son represented the father. And the moon in the dream represented the mother, and the 11 stars represented his other 11 brothers, how all of them was going to come one day and they was going to bow down to Joseph. And the Bible says that his brothers not only hated him, but they envied him. Oh, yeah, they envied him. Matter of fact, one day when they caught him away from the house, when you read the rest of this story, they was out in the field watching the sheep. And when they saw Joseph come, they came up with a plot and a plan to attack Joseph. And they say, let's get him and let's do away with him. And we're going to see what's going to happen then to his dream. And they thought about killing him, but rather than killing him, they said, no, let's just put him in the pit and let a lion or a tiger, bear or something come and kill him. And but then they said, no, let's just go on and sell him. And there was some merchants, people that was going to Egypt. And as they was coming back, they sold Joseph into Egypt for 20 pieces of silver. Ladies and gentlemen, see, envy will destroy a person's life. Envy will try to kill you. Envy will hate on you. All the haters come out when you start telling folks about your dream. Listen, that's why you can't be going around telling everybody about your dream. You can't go around telling everybody about your vision. You can't go around telling everybody whatever God done showed you. Why? Because people will start hating on you and people will envy you. I'm reminded of Dolly Parton. Dolly Parton, you know, she grew up very, very poor. You know Dolly Parton, the country and western singer. She grew up poor there in Tennessee, and her mama was going to make her a coat of many colors. And her mama showed up, was making her a coat of many colors. And Dolly Parton went to a school, and she was telling all the kids that, y'all laughing at me today, because I ain't got no nice clothes on. But one of these days, y'all going to see, I'm going to come up here with my coat of many colors. My mama is making me a coat of many colors. And sure enough, her mama finished the coat of many colors and put it on Dolly. And Dolly just couldn't wait to go to school the next day. And Dolly went to school the next day. And she told her brothers and sisters, y'all go on ahead of me, because I want to be last for class, and I want to make a grand entrance. And she did. Dolly was the last one that came to campus, and she come scrutting up there on the campus with that coat of many colors. Oh yeah, she was sporting that coat of many colors. Oh yeah, she was showing out that coat of many colors. She was parading in front of, but then all of a sudden, as she was walking there on campus and was parading on campus in that coat of many colors, some of the kids started laughing at her. And particularly one of this family, a boy and his other brothers and sisters, they started laughing at Dolly. And the boy said, listen, that ain't no coat of many colors. What that is, that's a coat of many rags. That's what that is. You're wearing a coat of many rags. And then hurt it, Dolly Parton feeling, and Dolly ran home. But the truth of the matter was, that same boy that was hating on Dolly was really envy of Dolly. He wished that he had what she had. Because see, at least Dolly Parton had some rags. They didn't even have no rags. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, see, folks will hate you and they'll envy you because they want what you got. Oh yeah, they may laugh at you, they may tease you, but they want what you got. Yeah, Joseph brothers, they probably was laughing at him and teasing him, but they wanted that coat of many colors that he had. They wanted the position that God was showing Joseph, that one day he was going to be a ruler and everybody else going to be bound down. They wanted Joseph's position of authority, how he was going to be a ruler one day. That's why they was hating on him. They was envying him because of his dream. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, be careful of telling folks your dream, because not everybody can handle your dream. I reminded one day, matter of fact, I learned this about over 30-some years ago when I was in seminary. Oh, it's about closer to 40 years now, when I was at Dallas Seminary. One day I was walking out there to my car with me and my friend, and I saw the professor. He got in this old beat-up car, and then he crunk it up, and then a smoke just came out of it, and the car was pitter-patting, poop, 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 and it just put it on down the road there, the street there. But I noticed that most of them professors in the professor parking lot over there, they didn't have no nice-looking cars. It was some... It looked like a used car lot over there. And so I turned to my friend, I said, listen, they must not pay these professors that much money. He said, no, they pay them pretty good. He said, well, why you make that statement? I said, because look over there in that parking lot. Them professors ain't got hardly no nice cars over there. And look at that professor there. He going home there, wherever he going, in a car and smoking like that, a trail of smoke. He said, listen, I guarantee you, if you follow that professor on home, I guarantee you there in his garage, he probably got a BMW or a Mercedes or a Lexus. He got some nice cars there at the house. I said, but he's being wise. He's being a smart man. He don't drive his nice stuff to work because he knows that a lot of people can't handle his blessings. See, you can't be parading in front of people with how God done bless you, because not everybody can handle your blessing. Oh, that brings me to my second point. So the first point, ladies and gentlemen, is people will hate you when you're blessed. But number two, people will lie on you when you're blessed. Look here at chapter 39. When we look at chapter 39, we see that Joseph now, he's there at Potiphar's house. Who was Potiphar? Potiphar was something like the security, head of security for Pharaoh. He was over the security. He was like Pharaoh's chief bodyguard. He was head of the secret service, if you please. But the Bible says that in verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hands. And the Bible says, and Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him and made him overseer over his house. And all that he had, he put into his hand. And it came to pass from time that he had made him overseers in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian house for Joseph's sake. And the blessings of the Lord was upon all that he had in his house and in the field. Now, you think about it, ladies and gentlemen. Joseph is there in Egypt, but the Bible says the Lord was with him and God was blessing Joseph. And because God was blessing Joseph, he was blessing everything that was around Joseph. And his master saw how Joseph was such a blessed man. He just made him overseer of everything that he had. Notice, the boy done worked from the bottom all the way up there to the top. See, you can't keep a good man down. And the Bible lets us know, because Joseph was such an attractive man. See, when you done work from the bottom to the top, then you are an attractive person. But not only attractive in position-wise, but I believe he was probably attractive physically. Probably was a good-looking fella, young man. And the Bible says that Pharaoh's Potiphar's wife started looking at Joseph. And she started making eyes at him and started saying, come on, Joseph, let's go to bed. In other words, in the words of that old soul song, come on and let's get it on. Woo! Let's get it on. But Joseph didn't want to get it on with her because Joseph recognized the sanctity of marriage. He said, no, my master done put me in charge of everything. I'm over everything. He done gave me everything except you, because you are his wife, and that's off limits. See, you got to know, ladies and gentlemen, where the boundaries are at. And so Joseph didn't want to cross those boundaries, but she kept on coming on to Joseph, until one day they was in a one-on-one situation, and she grabbed Joseph saying, come on. And she tried to force Joseph to come on and go to bed, but Joseph ran out of the house and ran out of his coat. He lost his coat, but he didn't lose his character. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen, you'll rather lose your coat, but don't lose your character. And Joseph ran out the house, but she lied there on Joseph. Look at this lie. Verse number 13, it says, and it came to pass when she saw that he had left his garments in her hand and was fled forth. See, her feelings now done got hurt. That she called unto the men of her house and spoke unto them, saying, see, he has brought in a Hebrew unto us to mock us. He came in unto me to lie with me, and I cried with a loud voice. And it came to pass when he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried, that he left his garments with me and fled and got him out. And she laid up his garments by her until the Lord came home. Now, look at that. She done lied on him. She done flipped the script. It wasn't Joseph came on to her, but she was coming on to Joseph. Do you see how she lied on Joseph and tried to make it look like that he was trying to rape her? Oh, ladies and gentlemen, do you see how this lady was just up to no good? See, when people can't use you like they want to use you, then they'll lie on you. Yeah. When you don't run with the crowd a lot of times on your job and stuff and get into sin with everybody else, then they'll lie on you. When they can't get you to participate in their sin or participate in their devilment, people will lie on you. And that's what this woman here, she lied on Joseph. But see, Joseph was a young, naive man. Matter of fact, he was 17 years old when he went there to Egypt. And so he was a very naive young man. See, when this lady was trying to come on to Joseph, Joseph should have fled then. The Bible says flee fornication. But don't wait too late to flee fornication. See, once a person showed himself as a snake, believe it. Yeah, once people show that they are up to no good, believe it. Once people show that they got devilment on their mind, believe them. Yeah, once they done showed you that they are low down, dirty snake, then you need to move away from them. Yeah. See, if a snake showed up right here at my feet, I wouldn't be sitting here talking. Now, snake, now you know you're not supposed to be in this church. You know, this is a church, the snake, and this is a place where we try to worship God, and snakes are not allowed. No, if a snake came up in here, I would get up and run. I would run from that snake. In the same way, when people done showed themselves as a snake, you're going to need to move around. As the other songwriter saying, you got to start trucking. Just keep on trucking. Yeah. You got to keep on trucking. You got to move around from those kinds of people once they show themselves a snake. Because if not, they're going to end up lying on you. Yes. That's why I asked the question, can you handle the distress of being blessed? Because when you're blessed, number one, people will hate you. But number two, people will lie on you. But number three, people will use you and then forget all about you. Did you hear what I said? when you bless, people will use you and then forget all about you. When you are blessed. Look right here in the text, chapter 40. When you come to chapter 40, you'll read that Joseph now is in prison. Yeah, he got to do time over a lie. Joseph is down there. But then Pharaoh must have had some kind of falling out with his chief butler and chief baker, because he done sent them to the slammer. They got to do some time. But the Bible lets us know Joseph done worked from the bottom to the top there in the prison. One day he looked at Pharaoh's chief butler and baker, and he saw that they weren't happy. He said, "Why you come y'all so sad?" And they said, "We done had a dream, but can't nobody interpret the dream." And Joseph, look at what he says at the end of verse 8. Joseph said, "Do not interpretation belong to God. Tell me them, I pray you." Well, the chief butler said, "Well, I'll go first." And he went on and he told Joseph, "I had a dream. I had a dream that there was a vine. And then there was three branches that came out on the vine. And then there were some clusters of grapes that came out on those branches. And then there was Pharaoh's cup appeared. And I saw myself holding Pharaoh's cup. And then I started squeezing the grapes there in Pharaoh's cup." Joseph said, "Oh, you had a good dream." He says those three branches represent 3 days. And in 3 days, Pharaoh is going to bring you back to your butlership and going to restore you to your butlership. And you're going to be giving Pharaoh some wine. Well, Joseph told him down here in verse number 14, after he had told him the interpretation of dream, look at verse 14. He said, "But think on me when it shall be well with thee, and show kindness, I pray thee, unto me, and make mention of me unto Pharaoh, and bring me out of this house." You know, even though Joseph had a big position in prison down there, he wasn't free. He says, "Don't you forget me." He says, "Tell Pharaoh about me and bring me on out of this house." Well, when the butler saw that, the baker saw that the butler dream went well, he said, "Hey, let me tell you my dream." He said, "Go ahead." He said, "What I dreamed that there was three baskets of fruit on my head, and it had all kind of fruit in those three baskets. And then some birds came and they was eating all the fruit in those baskets that was on my head." Joseph said, "Oh, I wish I didn't have to tell you the bad news, but you asked for the interpretation." He said, "Yours dream wasn't that good." He said, "Those three baskets represent 3 days. And in 3 days, Pharaoh is going to restore you to your bakership. But you're not going to be restored to do any kind of baking. He's going to bring you up to hang you. And because nobody's going to bury you, the birds is going to come and going to be picking your flesh." Well, did it happen like he said it was? Well, in verse number 20, it said, "And it came to pass the third day, which was Pharaoh's birthday, that he made a feast unto all his servants, and he lifted up the head of the chief butler and of the chief baker among his servants. And he restored the chief butler unto his butlership again, and he gave the cup into Pharaoh's hand. And he hanged the chief baker as Joseph had interpreted them. Yet did not the chief butler remember Joseph, but forgot him." Oh, can't you just imagine the disappointment of Joseph? Oh, I can imagine once the butler had been restored to his butlership, I can imagine Joseph was just dreaming down there. "Oh, yeah, it won't be long now before I'm going to be out of this place." It won't be long. I can imagine Joseph going around telling everybody, but listen, I'm going to be gone in a few minutes. You know, it was nice meeting you, probably high-fiving people, you know, getting them their arm bump. And back in the day, we used to do the butt bump and stuff. I can imagine him, you know, whatever the kind of bump they was doing back in the day. Well, Joseph was letting them know, hey, I'm getting ready to get out. I'm getting ready to get out. Getting ready to get out. Somebody came by, Joseph, are you still here? After a month done went by. Well, you know, they told me Pharaoh was having a birthday. You know, sometimes them birthdays can go, you know, 3, 4, 5 weeks. After 2 months done went by, Joseph was still there. 6 months done went by, Joseph still there. A year done went by, Joseph still there. A year and a half done went by. Reality done set in. That man done forgot Joseph. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, that's how people will do. People will treat you just like this piece of tissue. Then once they done use you, done blow their nose and done use you, then they'll ball you up, throw you away. They ain't got no more use for you. They'll forget all about you. That's why I'm asking you, can you handle the stress of being blessed? You can bless people, but people will forget all about how you done blessed them. Oh, can you handle the stress of being blessed? See, when you're blessed, people will hate you. When you're blessed, people will lie on you. When you're blessed, people will use you and forget about you. But when you're blessed, you'll be brought in before great men. Yeah, you'll stand before great men when you're blessed. In chapter 41, we read about how Joseph done been in prison now for 2 years, but all of a sudden, Pharaoh had a dream. Matter of fact, he had 2 dreams. And he called for the magicians, he called for the scholars, he called for the soothsayers. He said, y'all come and interpret the dream, but nobody could interpret the dream. Well, the butler finally remembered. He said, wait a minute. When I was in prison, there was a man by the name of Joseph, and I had a dream, and the baker had a dream, and he interpreted both of our dreams, and both dreams came true. Pharaoh said, get him. Go get that man. Well, when we get verse number 14, the Bible says, then Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they brought him hastily out of the dungeon, and he shaved himself, changed his raiment, and came in unto Pharaoh. See, when you're down there in prison a lot of time, particularly when you're disappointed, you don't really take care of yourself like you should. Verse number 15 tells us, and Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I have dreamed the dream, and there's none that can interpret it. And I've heard say of thee that thou can understand a dream to interpret it. And Joseph answered Pharaoh, saying, it is not in me. God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. Joseph said, no, you heard incorrectly. I ain't the one that can tell you, but God is the one that can tell you. Oh, see, that goes right back, ladies and gentlemen, to that Jesus sermon on the Mount when he gave those attitudes of the blessed. That first attitude, blessed are those that are pure in heart, for they shall see God. But then he says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And then he talks about, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. When you look at Joseph, Joseph had all of those attitudes of the blessed. But the one that I really like is when you blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And Joseph, he was a meek man. He was a real meek man. And then I like this other one over here in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. In that first one, ladies and gentlemen, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Yeah. Remember, I can't, but he can. That's what Joseph is basically saying. He's saying, I can't, but he can. I can't tell you in and of myself, but I know who can. I know who got that information. And he said, now go on and tell me your dream. And he said, basically, I had two dreams. The first dream was I had seven cows. Seven cows came along by the river, and they was drinking there by the river. But then seven skinny cows came along, and these seven skinny cows ate up these seven fat cows. But then I had another dream. I had a dream that there was seven stalks of corn, and they was fat stalks of corn. And then there came up seven thin stalks of corn, and the seven thin stalks of corn, they ate up the seven fat corns. He said, what do that mean? And he says, your dream, even though they're two, they're one and the same. What your dream basically means is the seven fat cows and the seven fat coins represent 7 years of plenty. And the seven thin coin and the seven thin cows represents 7 years of famine. And he said, God done showed Pharaoh what he about to do. God is getting ready to bring 7 years of plenty. I mean, it's just going to be fat. But then it's going to be followed by 7 years of famine. And the 7 years of famine is going to eat up the 7 years of plenty. He said, what you're going to have to do, Pharaoh, you're going to have to go find you a man that can administer this food distribution program where you can save as much as you can save during this 7 years of plenty, so that when the 7 years of famine come, you got something to fall back on. Well, guess what Pharaoh said? Pharaoh said, well, then you the man, Joseph. In verse number 38, Pharaoh said unto his servant, can we find such as one as this is a man in whom the Spirit of God is? And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as God hath showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. Thou shalt be over my house, and according unto thy word shall all my people be ruled. Only in the throne will I be greater than thou. In other words, he said, Joseph, I'm not just going to make you in charge of this food distribution program. He said, you're going to be second in command. He said, you're going to be second in command over everything that I got, Joseph. In other words, you're going to be riding in the second chariot. You're going to be just like my vice president, Joseph. Oh, my goodness. Oh, see, but that's going to bring a lot of stress, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, going from the bottom, going to the top like that, that's going to bring a lot of stress. Do you think that Joseph can handle the blessing, ladies and gentlemen? You think he can handle the stress of being blessed? Oh, I think he can. How do I believe that he can? It's because in verse number 38, the Bible says, and he had the Spirit of God in him. That's why Pharaoh gave Joseph that position, because Joseph had the Spirit of God in him. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I believe Joseph can handle the stress of being blessed because the Spirit of God was in him. See, when you got something great on the inside, you can handle the pressure on the outside when you got the Holy Spirit living on the inside. And Joseph had the Holy Spirit living on the inside so he could handle the pressure on the outside. See, that's how he can handle the pressure down there in the pit, because God's Spirit was with him. That's how he could handle the pressure there in Potiphar's house, because the Spirit was with him. That's how he could handle that pressure down there in the prison, because the Spirit was with him. That's how he gonna be able to handle the pressure there in the palace, because the Spirit is with them. And ladies and gentlemen, wherever Joseph was at, it's kept saying over and over and over, and the Lord was with him. See, when you got the Spirit of God with you, then the Lord is with you. The Lord was with Joseph there in the pit. The Lord was with Joseph there at Potiphar's house. The Lord was with Joseph there in the prison. The Lord was with Joseph there at Pharaoh's mansion there. Oh, the Lord was with him. And listen, just like the Lord was with Joseph, I believe that you can handle the stress of being blessed when God's Spirit is living on the inside of you. You can handle the stress of being blessed. Oh, yes, you can. Oh, yes. Yes. Listen, life is a stressful thing regardless. Whether you are blessed or whether you curse, life gonna be stressful. But I believe that you can handle the stress of being blessed when you got the Spirit of God living on the inside of you. Listen, when the haters come out, when you got God's Spirit on the inside of you, you can handle the stress of being blessed. Oh yeah, when they start lying on you, you can handle those lines because you got the Spirit of God living on the inside of you. When they even put you in a prison, I don't care how bad your situation is, you can handle the stress of being blessed. Whether you're at the bottom or whether you're at the top, you can handle the stress of being blessed. And when you got the Spirit of God in you, you got a special gift, ladies and gentlemen. And the Bible says your gift will make room for you, and it'll bring you in before great men. Joseph had that gift of interpreting dreams, and his gift made room for him, brought him before great men. And listen, when you got the Spirit of God in you, you're going to handle the stress of being blessed, because the Bible says greater is he that is within me than he that's in the world. I believe you can handle the stress of being blessed. As I come to a close, I heard a story one day about this master brick mason. Oh, this was a master brick mason. I mean, this guy was really, really good in laying bricks. Matter of fact, he had laid bricks for people all over the world, for doctors, lawyers, all kind of teachers, politicians, mayors and senators and what have you. And he would always put some kind of fancy designs and stuff in his brick work. That's why people liked it and stuff, because he was real good in his craft. But one day, as he was out there working one hot summer day, a little boy showed up. And he said, "Mister, aren't you hot out here?" He said, "Yep." He said, "But you still laying bricks out here in this heat?" He said, "Yep." He said, "You must like what you do." He said, "Yep." He said, "I don't see how you do it." He said, "If that was me, I couldn't do it. I couldn't be out here in this 100-degree temperature. How in the world can you work out here in this 100-degree temperature?" The man, he put the mortar on the brick, laid another brick, and then he came and he looked at that little boy and he said, "Son, I was born to do this." Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I know that you can handle the stress of being blessed when you have been born again. You got the Spirit of God living on the inside of you. And when people look at you and they see what you are doing and they say, "Oh, I don't see how they're going to be able to do that. How can they do that?" Just let them know, "I was born to do this." Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We praise you for who you are. Take this message and use it to bring honor and glory to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Side we are not consumed. Evil may endure the night, but we are not consumed. Great is your faithfulness. All my days I've seen no less. Worry tries to take our minds, but we are not consumed. Dark, but love is light, he is not consumed. Great is your faithfulness. All my days I've seen no less. And I see you in the wilderness and in green fields. I see you with the broken heart, and when I
another wonderful program. Thank you so kindly for joining us today. But we'd never like to leave our broadcast without giving you an opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So if you would like to receive Christ as your personal Savior, just bow your head and pray this short prayer with me. Father, I have sinned and come short of your glory. Forgive me of my sins. I confess with my mouth Jesus is Lord, and I believe with all my heart that God has raised him from the dead. Based on the word of God, I now believe that I'm now saved. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, now go tell somebody about that decision that you've just made, because that's the greatest decision that anybody could have ever made. So go and let them know that you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And continue to keep tuning in and watching us on Sunday morning and Wednesday night. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors even about us. All right, now that's it for today, family. That's it for today. Now listen, go out and make this a great day in the Lord. Now hopefully, that y'all can have an old-fashioned meal, some collard greens, you know, where you can go ahead and dip your, get some cornbread. And, you know, they used to use no forks. People just used to use their fingers for the forks and stuff. So now that's being real, real country. But go out and make this a great day in love. Whatever you have, just give God thanks for it. And move on. Amen. All right. Listen now, family. Stay encouraged. I say stay encouraged, because God loves you and so do I. And there's nothing you can do about it. God bless you. Have a good day in the Lord. Bye-bye. Yeah.
there are mercies there.